Good evening and welcome once again to another edition of the Truth Tower. My name is Johnny Guzman. As always, a pleasure to be here sharing truth. Tonight, we have a special guest from the United Kingdom, Simon Parks. He's going to be with us to talk about this interesting topic, the hidden Illuminati, all the stuff that's going on behind closed doors that we at times just think about or heard about. But here's a guy who we can say knows the real deal. He's also had experience with extraterrestrial life or entities. We're going to get all that information from Simon in just a few seconds. He's also a local politician over in England, and that's pretty strange within itself, because a politician that talks about these things, well, we're going to get the inside scoop on what Simon has to say about the hidden world of the Illuminati. Before we start, I'd like to remind you to go into our webpage. This is the new season, 2013. Just a reminder that our schedule of programming will be from Monday through Thursday. Mondays and Tuesdays, we're doing the format in English. Wednesdays and Thursdays, we do it in Spanish. You can go into our website, qltelevision.com. Right now, it's only in Spanish, but it should be up and running within the next couple of days, the English part, so that you can check out all the stuff that we're doing, all the services that we're providing, ebooks, videos, programs, documentaries, and so forth. QLtelevision.com. And of course, visit our new fan page on Facebook, QL Television. And for all of our programs in English and in Spanish, go to our YouTube channel, QL Television. Okay, very well. Let's bring in Simon. Hello, Simon. Welcome to the program, and thanks for being here with us tonight.
Hello, it's lovely to be with you, and lovely to speak with your listeners.
Simon, so let's begin with, you're a city councilman, okay? You're a politician.
Yeah.
Just briefly tell us a little bit about that, because I find that kind of strange that you're a politician and you're talking about these things. How is it that they haven't kicked you out or sort of put you on that blacklist? So just tell us a little bit about that, Simon.
Yes, there are not many of us who have positions of office that will talk openly. The reason that I'm speaking openly is because I've had personal experiences, because my family came from an intelligence, military intelligence background, and I've been a politician for a number of years, and I do my job very well, returned at office. So there is no argument for trying to get rid of me. March of last year, there was an attempt made on my life. My car was rammed off the road. I had a passenger with me, but we were okay. So politically, it's quite difficult for the powers that be, because here I am holding office and being prepared to speak about the truth. So, yes, you're right. It does cause them some aggravation. But my electorate, the people I represent, are very much behind me and support me 100%.
Yeah, that was my next question, because usually, I shouldn't say the majority of the people, but a good percentage of the people don't really care about this stuff. You know, they're focused in on their soccer games over there in England. I'm sure Manchester United, Arsenal, and so forth. Over in the States, it's, you know, the Giants and the Colts. And pretty much, if a politician begins to talk about these things, you know, they either don't care or categorize you as being nuts. So it's pretty strange. But you were also telling me in before we came on the air that your family, your grandfather, was also involved as a Freemason, Illuminati. Tell us a little bit about that, Simon.
Yes, my grandfather, an incredibly interesting man, dead now. He was a high-ranking British diplomat. He was based at the British Embassy in India, and he was a British consul. He was also quite a senior Mason, and he worked for British intelligence, the foreign arm, which is known as MI6. Highly decorated with British medals, not for military, but for services to Her Majesty the Queen. He was given the Order of the British Empire, Commander of the British Empire, and they offered him a knighthood to make him Sir James Marsland. but he fell out with the prime minister of the day and refused to accept that. And so as a present to him, they asked him to represent Britain, the United Kingdom, at the United Nations. So he was Britain's guy who went to the United Nations to talk about trade, all the trade between different countries. So my grandfather, very much involved in the intelligence. Now my mother, his daughter, she worked for another arm of British intelligence, the domestic arm, which is called MI5. And her job was to type out documents that related to crashed UFOs. And she did that from 1971 until 1979. So I grew up, I was a schoolboy during that period of time, and I grew up in what was a very interesting environment.
So Simon, while you're growing up, are you seeing any strange things within your family, or was pretty much everything kept a secret? You just knew that your dad worked for the government. Did you see any strange things, any experiences during the time that you were a teenage boy growing up, Simon?
First of all, I come from a single parent family. My mother never married again. She never had any boyfriends. And you know, you either get very close with your parent or you don't. And I was close in the sense that we had no secrets. When I talk to researchers, I'm not a researcher. I experience these things. I don't have the time to research it, which is a shame. But when I speak to researchers and tell them that I was in the room while my mother talked with her security handler, they say that's very unusual that should happen. The only time I was ever asked to leave the room was when she had to sign the Official Secrets Act to say that she was going to accept the conditions that the government put her under. But every other time then I was present, and I overheard a huge range of conversations between her and these different guys from the military who would come and go. Mother worked at home. In terms of experiences, I've experienced all my life. The beings that I normally see, the beings that come to collect me, in America, researchers call them mantis. In Britain, we call them mantid. The other major entities that I'm very familiar with are the draconious reptilians. I don't see many of the little greys, which is perhaps unusual. And also the species that come from Orion or from Sirius, which have called the feline or the lion species. So it's mainly the mantis, the reptilian, draconis reptilian, because there are many sorts of reptilian, and then the feline species. So yes, it's been ongoing ever since I can remember.
Simon, wait a minute. Let's backtrack a little bit. You're saying that you're being contacted, you have these experiences. Are you talking about while you're awake or when you're in a state of a dream or astral or sleep? What do you mean?
Very much awake. I one of these very unusual people that don't have my experiences in a dream or anything like that. No, it happens during the day. I mean, I've been taken while I've been in a car with a passenger, and my passenger's been taken as well. And you know, this particular passenger is an eyewitness to that, and she experienced what I experienced. I mean, I'm married. The beings will come into the house. They'll appear in the house while my wife is there. It's a very ongoing and a very complex relationship, and I don't think it's any coincidence that I've come from a family that was heavily involved in British security. And I just want to make this point for your listeners that when my mother was told that she was going to work for British intelligence, what she was actually told was that British intelligence were handling her, but she was actually working for the National Security Agency, the NSA of America. So the NSA were actually behind it, they organized it. But because my mother lived in Britain, MI5, the British Security Service, did all the day-to-day stuff.
So it's the NSA who's behind this. It's not
absolutely. It's not the British government. Yeah, the National Security Agency. It was the National Security Agency and the National Reconnaissance Office, but it was the NSA that did all the groundwork. Yes.
So Simon, obviously we're going to have a group of people that are going to say, well, you know, he's another one that's talking about the, you know, being in contact with these beings. So how can we somewhat show proof or you know, this is just your words. You know, I mean, you're saying what I'm experiencing. Yeah, how can anyone doubt that or confirm that? But fully, is there anything?
I fully understand that. And you know what? If somebody's not prepared to do the research on me and see all the number of interviews on British television, the Huffington Post, all the bits and pieces that I've done as a politician, then you know, they must have their head in the sand. But I'm not stupid enough to expect people to believe me. I'm coming out with my story for two reasons. The first one is to say to people, your government lies to you. Your government knows an awful lot more and is not telling you the truth. And the other reason that I decided to go public with this was because I thought there are an awful lot of people out there who have experiences but have nobody to turn to. When I first decided that I was going to go public, although I live in Britain, I approached the MUFON network, which covers both the Americas, the North and the South. And I was one of the very, very few non-American people to be accepted by MUFON. And the reason that happened was that I sent them some drawings of the entities that I have seen, and the director of MUFON, within 7 minutes of me emailing from Britain to America, said, right, you're on board. So MUFON had no doubt that there was something that interested them. The very fact that I'm a politician and have not been removed from office, because in Britain, I don't know what it's like in other countries, but if you are insane or you're nuts, then you cannot be a politician. You're removed from office. But here I am doing an interview with you, and I have done lots of interviews, and I'm not removed from office because the powers that be really don't know how to deal with me because of my background. I've come from a very, very strong intelligence-led background. And, you know, there's a lot in my head which could cause them some aggravation. So if people choose not to believe me, hey, that's fine. You know, I will tell my story because it's my truth.
That's right. Simon, okay, so there's, I mean, we hear the word Illuminati and we think, you know, bad. But the word Illuminati in Spanish is iluminado, right? It's got the light on.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that. There's two groups of these Illuminatis, the dark guys and the light workers, let's call them. Tell us a little bit about that, Simon.
Okay, well, when you go on the internet, and the YouTube, it's Illuminati this and Illuminati that, and unfortunately a lot of people who mean well do not really understand. How could they? They've not been privy to the secret workings of these organizations. They couldn't know. But there are in fact three groups of Illuminati. There are the ones I refer to as the dark wizards, who are very high Masonic members, who have satanic rituals and rites, and these are the bad guys. Then there's the opposite. My grandfather was one of the light Illuminati or white Illuminati who tend to work for the good of mankind. And in the middle, there's a whole range of these very, very, very intelligent, powerful people who just do their own research and they don't get drawn into one side or the other. But when you see on YouTube the word Illuminati, what people are usually referring to are the bad guys.
So we're talking about these dark wizards that you call them.
Yes.
Do you have any experiences, or have you seen any of these rituals that these dark wizards do? Satanic rituals? Have you seen any of this?
Yes. You have to, or your listeners would have to understand that. If you have become a very, very powerful man, you're generally a man. A woman can become a witch. But if you're a very, very powerful man in terms of the amount of money that you have and you've invested in a wide range of organizations, you wield incredible power. And so you are invited to join one of these organizations. And you will find that you form a brotherhood which has a Masonic link. And in order to bind that brotherhood together, you will be required to undertake some very disturbing rituals, the object of which is to make you so wedded, I can use that word, wedded to the organization, that you could never ever leave that organization or turn your back on them. So it's not just ceremonies, it's actually a form of religion. Some of these people at the very, very top have some incredible dark magic powers, and can use them very effectively. So it's a very well-kept secret, but due to the internet and a lot of researchers, more and more is coming out about this group.
Simon, who can you say for sure, or are you allowed to say, can you name any names? Tony Blair, perhaps, or one of those guys, George Bush? Who are you talking about?
Well, you've already named two. You know, certainly here in England, Her Majesty the Queen, although she's a woman, would certainly be a person who would give instructions to such a group. You had the Bushes. You have even Hillary Clinton at the moment. Do not for one minute think that a president of the United States gets to that position because of his ability. You know, the Americans had one president that I'm aware of who was a man of high integrity, and he was murdered by his own people. And I refer to JFK, of course. Every other president is there because it was designed that he would be there, because he would toe the line and he would follow through with the agenda. So anybody who has a position of immense power must be a member of that group, because they could not afford to have such a powerful person outside of their control.
Are they also involved with these draconian reptilians? I mean, we hear the word reptilians as well, and we think of lizards, you know, snakes, reptiles that, you know, are evil. Are we talking about that kind of draconian reptilians, Simon?
Yes. I mean, if you look on YouTube, unfortunately, the drawings that you see don't match what I am used to. I'm working with a forensic artist at the moment to render some artwork, and my next presentation in England, next UFO conference, will be in March. And I'm hoping to have some of his artwork to put up on the viewing screen so that people can have a much clearer idea of what these beings look like. Go back to your question. The humans who have these positions of power look up to the draconian reptilians as their gods. They basically receive their instructions from these beings and have done for thousands of years. You go back to ancient Egypt, you go back to the Sumerian times and times before that. What's happening at the moment is that these dark wizards are attempting to set up their own power base. They're turning their back on their gods simply because what's called the New World Order has not been delivered to them as quickly as they expected it. And as a result of that, these people have got their backs up against the wall. They're under terrible pressure, and they're fighting amongst themselves. So unfortunately for humanity, for the next 2 to 3 years, it's going to be rather difficult, but the long-term prospect's quite good.
So you're saying, let me see if I understood you correctly, the George Bushes and the Queen of England, they answer to these reptilians, but now they sort of want to do their own thing, and because of that, there's chaos or there's conflict within them?
Right. That at that senior level, okay, such as the Bushes or the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, no, that level retains a healthy respect for what we would call off-worlders. The problem arises in middle management as you come down from that top grouping, these handful of people who dictate which way the major economies of the world will go. as you come down through the command structure, you have a number of people who might be controllers of a state in America or in Britain. They might be, you know, in control of a city of 2 or 3 million. Those people now are tending to want to set themselves up as their own power base and not take instructions from on high. And these are the problems that we're getting, because these people now are becoming rogue. And you might find that a large amount of money is withdrawn from a corporation which wasn't authorized, or you might find something else has happened. So what you've got is individuals who are looking to protect themselves. If there's an economic collapse round the corner, a lot of people in the know are trying to draw their money out very quickly and exchange them for something that will be negotiable in the future. So there's an awful lot going on at the moment throughout the Western world.
Okay, so tell us a little bit about the difference of these groups that you have come in contact with, the mantis and the draconian reptilians, Simon.
Both groups refer to themselves as coming from the fourth frequency. So you would know that as the fourth dimension. They're very clear that that is the area they live in. I use the word ET or extraterrestrial quite simply because that is the terminology that everybody's familiar with. If I was to be absolutely accurate, they're not extraterrestrial, they are extra dimensional. They don't spend thousands of years traveling in a spaceship to get here. They are able to access a portal, what Albert Einstein and others refer to as a wormhole. But we'll just call it a portal for tonight's talk. So they can access a portal and they can come into our reality, either in a spaceship or just physically themselves. The mantis call that because they have a very strong resemblance to a praying mantis, a very ancient race. I'd say they were benevolent to humans. They have their own agenda, but they're not out to kill anybody. They have their own plan. Whereas you've got the draconis reptilians, who have been interfering in humanity's workings for thousands of years, do unfortunately kill, have no compunction in taking action that would enable them to control the earth a little bit better. So you have two very powerful groups who have been involved in humanity's manipulation for a very long time. There are other groups, but those other groups tend to not become involved in the manipulation of humanity simply because they think it's the wrong thing to do.
Okay, Simon, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, okay. I want to ask you, why have they chosen you? So why are they being in contact with you? When we come back from the break, I want you to answer that. We'll be right back.
That's fine.
Okay, and we're back to the Truth Tower. My name is Johnny Guzman. We're talking to Simon Parks from the UK. Okay, Simon, so why you? So that's the question that many are probably asking. Well, why are they in contact with you and not with, you know, Joe Blow from the corner? Why you?
All right, Johnny. Hi. First of all, there's nothing special about me. I'm just like anybody else. However, I'm of great interest to them. And don't think I'm the only person they're contacting. There are literally thousands of people on this planet that are being contacted. The great majority of them don't come forward and don't wish to discuss it because they just wouldn't be able to handle all the media attention that comes their way. Those people that are brave enough to come forward and tell their story, that's great. In my case, it's genetics. They've made it very clear that my body is a body that interests them. They are creating a hybrid race. They have been attempting to create a hybrid race for a long time. And there are a number of people on the Earth whose genetics are suitable to exist in a third dimension, which is what we are now. Well, in actual fact, we're probably 3.4, 3.5 now. But we're able to exist in a higher dimension, so that when the time comes and these hybrids can come to Earth, they have a greater chance of survivability. So that's primarily the reason.
Simon, but why so much interest in this little tiny planet of ours that, you know, we're pretty much in the boondocks of the universe? I mean, there's so many planets and so many life outside our planet Earth. So that's the part that I still don't quite understand, or it's, you know, the logical left brain of mine is not understanding. Why so much fighting over this tiny little planet in the boondocks of the Milky Way, Simon?
Well, Johnny, you're right. As a planet, we are tucked away in a forlorn cul-de-sac or dead end. However, the entities that come to collect me refer to this planet as a water world, and there are very few vibrant water worlds like the Earth. There is such a diverse amount of life on this planet. Now, the other thing is that we revolve around our sun every year, which means that our life on this planet has a very short life expectancy. Through radiation from the sun, our bodies are broken down and degenerate very quickly. That means we evolve very quickly, we adapt to change very quickly, and we are fascinating to study. Back 100 plus years ago, they were doing some tests. These are humans were doing tests on moths, and they found that when the Industrial Revolution came, all these moths changed their pigmentation to black because of all the smoke coming out of the chimneys when they were burning coal. And within 30, 40 years, these moths started to change to black, and the white moths just died out. As a planet with a diverse range, we are fascinating to observe. And that's what they're doing. They're observing us.
So when they take you, is that what you said? They take you physically? What do they do with you? So are you afraid? I mean, are they using you? Aren't you afraid? Or what is it that they do with you, Simon?
No, I'm not afraid. I'm very privileged. When I was about 11 and a half years old, I'm very privileged to remember I made an agreement with them. Researchers refer to this as a soul contract. Most people don't ever remember their contract. I actually had a verbal contract. It's nothing written. It's an agreement that you make. And I agreed to let them come and collect me. And I'll tell you the terms of the contract. I was taken onto a spaceship. I was hysterical. I was not even 12 years old. I was very upset. And the being comes up to me, puts his two hands on my shoulders, and makes me an offer. And they don't speak with their mouths. All messages are sent straight to your brain. And the message was, would you like to be like us, to have knowledge and understanding, to see the future and know the past, to have power and authority? That was the deal offered. And I was so excited about knowing about the past and have a chance to see the future, that I said, yes, that's what I want to do. And then his hand just came off my shoulder, took my hand, and he said, then come with me. And I think I spent 2 days there. I know that because I had to sleep. I had to have a bed. I had to go to sleep. So I knew I was there for more than just one day. Because I can remember making an agreement, I know that it was consensual. These beings have never hurt me, not once. Yes, I've been on an operating table and been prodded about, but that's, I've agreed to that. That's something that I had to do. The final part of your question was, what do they do? Generally speaking, I'm taken off the Earth, but not for long periods of time, and I'm shown around a spaceship, or I'm asked to interact with a machine. Sometimes they want to do things to my body if they say that I'm not sick, but I will become sick unless they do something. We have, I say, conversations. Again, it's done through mind to mind. So it's not your usual story of somebody being visited at the night and then they go rigid, they can't move, and they're taken and done and dumped back. It's never been like that for me. And because it's more positive, then I feel that I am able to talk about it. If, you know, God willing, you know, that's the way it is. But had it been the other way, as so many people have a very bad experience, it probably wouldn't want to talk to you about it because I would be too traumatized. And since I went public, I have a heck of a lot of people contacting me, asking for advice, wanting to tell me their story. And you know what? Most of them have very, very harsh stories to tell. I'm just very fortunate.
But why is their story harsh and yours not? Why?
Because I actually asked on one occasion. There was one person that really tugged at my heartstrings, because she said to me that what was happening, that she was being taken at night, and she remembers being put on an operating table, and then they wouldn't talk to her, they didn't communicate with her, and then they would just return her. And she said the worst part was not the fear, but the very fact they didn't communicate to her. And then when I had an opportunity to ask this question of these beings, I said, why are you doing that? And they don't have emotions as humans do. They have feelings, but not emotions. And I'm quite shocked. And basically they were saying, well, she shouldn't remember. We don't communicate what we're doing with these people because basically they're not supposed to remember. Why would we talk to them when they're not going to remember? So what was happening in that particular woman's instance was that her conditioning was breaking down and she was getting recollections and memories back. They intend me to remember stuff. It's much more of a two-way process. I don't consider myself a contactee as somebody like Alex Collier. Alex Collier, I think, is the archetypal contactee. I don't mix with beings from a much higher frequency. I think Alex was meeting people from the sixth or seventh dimension who are very benevolent to humanity. The beings that I am in contact with are ambivalent to humanity. But I have a much more two-way conversation with them.
So what is the, in other words, what's the promise they're making to you in order for you to be in touch with them and let them study you or whatever they do with you? So what is the end result for you?
What did you say, what's in it for me?
Yeah, or what's the end result for you? I mean, so what are you going to get out of this? It sounds like to me like they're using you and they're, I don't know, sucking up your energy. I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong. But so what benefit does this give you? Are they giving you knowledge? Do you know what's going to happen in the next couple of years? Are you seeing things that the average folk cannot see? So what is in it for you, in other words?
Well, that's a very human thing, isn't it? I mean, you know, what's in it for you? That's how we are on this planet. We're money mad, we're possession mad. You know, there must be something in it for you. That's the paradigm that we need to move away from, you know, Johnny. But it's a fair question and I won't run away from it. What I get out of it is the fantastic knowledge that I am privileged to actually meet and communicate with something that we are taught in schools does not exist. That in itself is just wonderful for me. That a fantastic, you know, sometimes I'm at home and I'm quite domesticated, and when my wife's out at a meeting, I will vacuum the house. And I'm standing, I'm thinking, what on earth am I doing vacuuming this floor when yesterday I was in a spaceship doing this? And I'm forever comparing my life on this mundane planet with its pathetic rules and regulations and its crazy addiction to money with the world that's up there where money doesn't exist and the values are different. In terms of what I get out of it, yes, I have the opportunity to put questions to them regarding the future of the Earth, and they are fairly okay with answering me. Sometimes the answers aren't as full as I would like, but they've never turned around to me yet and said, you know, we're not discussing that. I have always had answers. So yes, I have a little bit of knowledge regarding the future of this Earth. But whether that's just as a reward for being a good boy and playing the game, I don't know. But I come back to the point that I have never been hurt. They ask my permission before they do something. That is almost unheard of in the contactee, abductee world. But they will speak to me and say, can we do this? Do you object? And, you know, even humans aren't as nice to you, are they?
So if you say no, you don't want to go with them, yeah, then they just basically leave you alone.
Yeah, as perhaps a good example would be fairly recently, I was taken to what appears to be an underground base. The walls are very rough-hewn rock, and I have to stand up against some sort of metal armature, and there are these are not humans, they are doctors. You know, aliens have professions just as humans do, and I'm not happy about the position I'm in, and I'm moving, and the alien in charge says, you have to keep very still because we're going to use this device which fires a beam, and if you move about you could injure yourself. And he says to me, are you going to follow the direction of your doctors? Because the doctors are getting quite stressed and saying, you know, you mustn't move around. And if I'd said no, that would have been the end of it. They would have said, right, well, we can't do this procedure. It's a very unusual relationship.
But Simon, give me an example of the knowledge that they're sharing with you. So you're doing this, I understand what you're saying. Yes, my question before, that what's in it for you?
Okay, but I understand your question. I'll give you an answer. There's a device on the Swiss-French border called the Hadron Collider, sometimes called the CERN device. Officially, it cost $2 billion to build. The reality is it cost $4 billion to build. It's not owned by a private company. It's ultimately owned by the American government, who lent on all the major Western countries to raid their black budgets to pay for this device. The lie was put out that it was to find the boson particle or dark matter. And in this world, we were talking about money. Nobody provides $4 billion for no return, but in effect there's no return for this. So no private consortium is involved, it's military. And I had a conversation, I've had a number of conversations starting from September of last year regarding the true use of this device, and it became apparent to myself and some others that this device had to be taken out, for want of a better word. It didn't, so that it couldn't operate. Now, you will have heard all about December 21st, 2012, the Ascension Day, and there's been a lot of nonsense written about it. But it's no surprise that the Hadron Collider was scheduled to activate on the 17th of December and run right through until the 22nd of December. I have been sent, and I've shared it on a couple of other websites, I've been sent a screenshot of a computer screen from the facility which showed that it failed to operate between the 17th of December and the 22nd of December. This device, the CERN device, was only built for one purpose, which was to maintain a portal between this world and another. Now that's failed, and if your listeners go online and do a bit of research, you will see they're absolutely panicking and they want to build another one with a circumference of 50 miles. 50 miles, which will cost somewhere in the region of $10 billion. And they want this built by 2015 because that is their last opportunity, because come 2016, no more portals can be opened. The Earth will have moved so far from galactic center that they will not be able to open any portals. So that's one piece of information. And, you know, you heard it here, folks, first, because I'm on, you think of Project Camelot, there's Cassidy and Bill Ryan. I'm actually on Bill Ryan's Project Avalon. It's very kindly let me come onto his website and post my remarks there. And before Christmas, I was telling people this is the law. So, yeah, there's some very useful information that comes through to me.
So they're building this portal to go where or to do what? To go...
Now, the portal already existed. That was the point. The portal has already existed. Some of your listeners may be familiar with the term Anunnaki. I refer to them simply as the Anu, because that's what they refer to themselves as. This portal had existed since Sumerian times and allows these beings to bring forward reinforcements or replacements. With the portal closed, as it is now, they are effectively isolated on Earth. And they're desperate to open another portal. That's why they need to build another machine.
These are the Anunnaki that you're talking about. The Sumerian,
yes.
Enki and Lil and these guys.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And you're saying that by 2016, if they don't hurry up and build another CERN, or they're just going to miss it. And what's going to happen? They stay here and what happens? Everything is known?
Well, what will happen is that there will be a false flag alien invasion, followed by an attempt to set up a single government, a one world government. If they can get the one world government up, they want to RFID chip every human being in the Western world. A lot of whistleblowers have said that the Dark Illuminati's plan is to wipe out the human population by 2 billion or 3 billion. And that was a plan 20 years ago. Technology has moved on now. You don't need to wipe out 2 billion, 3 billion people if you can stick a chip, an RFID chip in them, because if they don't do what you want, you just turn the chip off. So the plan to control humanity is to have everybody chipped. So that's basically the way they're looking for.
Okay, Simon, we have a few more minutes left, but I want you to... So what is it that we should be doing? So what is it? Understand the system a little bit more. What is your suggestion? What is your advice for people to do?
I understand your question. It is down to particularly the American military. The question is whether the American military will follow the orders they're going to be given. Will the American military shoot on their own people? Will the American people resist what's going to happen? Once the high-powered weapons are taken off them, this is all part of the plan, once those high-powered weapons come out of the citizens' hands, then we might begin to see some very overt action. What your listeners and every decent man and woman can do is form little associations, little clubs. They can talk to each other. They can try and offer support and help. And they've got to be able to resist the lies that are going to be force-fed down people's throats. Because if this incident occurs, you'll find the internet will be turned off. Mobile phones will be switched off. The only news you're going to get will be through official government channels. And if people, even in isolated areas, can make contact with other people, form a support network, then you at least have your friends to fall back on.
So this is if they don't get their way by 2016?
I think we're going to see this before 2016. If they haven't got it by 2015, they're in real trouble. They are in real trouble. 2016 is that's it, period. They can't do anything. They've had it. So any, you know, cards, aces out of the pack, they've got to play between now and 2015.
So in the meantime, Simon, isn't there anything that, you know, sort of anybody that's good that would come and say help us out, or simply it's just the same old story that look, we have to look within ourselves to wake up and smell the coffee and see what's going on? So no outside intervention, as we hear in the New Age that the ascended masters are going to come down and blah 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 blah. So it's basically up to us to understand.
Yeah. I mean, you know, people always want the 7th Cavalry to come charging in. They want someone else to do the dirty work, someone else to take responsibility. The problem is that humanity has been lied to for so long that it's fallen asleep. And when I've discussed with these aliens that come to collect me, and I've argued for humanity, and I've said, how can people make a choice when they don't have the full truth? There's not a level playing field. The scales aren't balanced. And what's been happening over the last 18 months is the scales are being slowly balanced. That doesn't mean that all the hard work's going to be done for you guys. What's got to happen is the scales have got to be balanced, and then the human population has got to decide where it's going. What is it going to do? Is it going to carry on living this life of nonsense, basically? Or is it going to take a very bold step? Let me put it to you this way. Why is a nurse in a hospital who saves a child's life paid less money than a man in a bank who makes millions of pounds for his bank manager and their shareholders? Why does Western society value money more than life? And until humanity can get to grapple with these really fundamental issues, it hasn't got much hope.
Yeah, and I would add to that, they reward stupidity, you know, these silly programs on television, you know, singers and so forth. That seems to be the in thing, and, you know, let's reward you for being stupid. Anyway, that's all the time we have, Simon Parks. Thank you very much for sharing this hour with us. Good luck to you, Simon Parks. You're a city councilman. In what town are you a city councilman?
In Whitby, in Britain, United Kingdom.
Okay. Good luck to you, my friend, and keep sharing truth.
Delighted to speak with you and your listeners. Take care yourself. Okay. Bye-bye now.
Thank you. Ciao. Okay, folks, that's going to do it for us. Thank you for being here in this hour. I just want to remind you to send us your invitations to Facebook and also to go to our fan page. Here you can see it on the screen, QL Television, for all of our programs in English and in Spanish. Go to our YouTube channel, QL Television. And also don't forget to go to our webpage, QLtelevision.com. There you're going to see all the stuff that we're doing here in our programs and in Quantum Leap Television. Have yourself a good night, and I'll see you tomorrow. Ciao.